Also, by having Harry be alone, it would have highlighted his loneliness even more. Rowling could have cut so much of the first chapter down.
J.K. Rowling.
One more thing, it could have cut the chapter in half. And that is cutting Dudley's friends out and just having Harry and Dudley then get attacked by the Dementors. Then the second half of the chapter could have been an outpost scene where he gets expelled. We have an entire chapter dedicated to just letter after letter, and one of the reasons why I think Rowling added this was because it worked so well in the third book in the chapter called Outpost. But the difference between these two chapters was that in the third book, Outpost was the very first chapter, and she used the letters as a way of touching with someone in his life. But in the fifth book, this doesn't work, because it was put in a place where the action had long since started, an entire Dementor attack in place, and many conversations and fights had taken place as well. So the focus on the letters sort of slows the action and accepts them down. Had they combined Sirius and Arthur's letters, which
basically said okay?
The same thing, and combined the two ministry letters,
call
they could have saved so much time and combined the Dementor attack and the letters in the same chapter, by driving the excitement of the Dementor attack into the Howling. Making all of this happen in the first chapter would have made for one of the most exciting openings in many of the Harry Potter books. Got the reader super engaged in the span of one chapter and in the most important chapter. And going off of that, this book takes forever to start the actual plot.
Not cool, man.
Until halfway through chapter 10, this opening alone before we get to Hogwarts.
Oh, so dig me.
The book in the first series, which is 17 chapters. And that book had the task of
setting
up the growth of the readers. But this book drags on into the
This is bad. This,
what are you doing?
He's just a lynx, brother. He's a lynx. Yeah, he's just a lynx.
No, he isn't.
Just go to sleep already.
Fluffy isn't around.
Everywhere under from our bed. Just some lynx. Siberian lynx.
Yeah, I'm so sad, Ty. Why that douchebag makes it out with his deer.
Cause the deer.
I don't care.
Now, I know I can't say that this isn't how serious should be, because J.K. Rowling knows every little detail about all of her characters. For me to say that Sirius doesn't act like Sirius in this novel might come off as me being automatically wrong, but I'm going to explain. Sirius Black was introduced as the prisoner of Azkaban.
Oh, no!
He's on the run and was one man alive. He put his entire life at risk to get Harry and Cooper to stand after his mortal stroke. And to do this, he had to take steps that could easily reveal his location, especially if someone realized that the money was coming out of his vault and then shipping to Hogwarts. He also risked his identity by stepping onto the Hogwarts grounds to watch Harry fly in his Quidditch match. And at the time, the grounds were flooded with pretty much the whole school, and he knew that Lupin was working there, and that Lupin knew his enemy was born.
Yeah, what
are you... After finding out that Harry was in the driver's corner, Sirius once again risked being captured as he traveled halfway around the world to make it back to Hogwarts so he could protect Harry. Clearly, he would have gone to any length to
protect
and be with Harry. But now, let's look at the order
of events.
When the two are finally reunited after many months, Sirius barely acknowledges Harry. Instead, screaming at his mother's painting, telling her to shut up, then says very grimly, not exciting, grimly, "Hello, Harry. I see you met my mother." They then discuss his mother and his family, a very anticlimactic reunion. This is one of those things that I said happened so much in the Order of the Phoenix movie, where I find myself liking the film version better than the book. In the film, the reunion is touching and puts a smile on your face, but here, Sirius is just so dull and not at all happy to see Harry, which seems out of character based on the examples I just gave from the other books, where clearly, Sirius is going to any length to make Harry happy with the new story. And doing anything he could to protect and be with Harry, traveling all the way back to Hogwarts, and while there, he lived in the mountains of Hogsmeade. lived on rats. Shortly after this, they discussed Harry's lousy summer and the Dementor attack, a very scary and traumatic incident for Harry, and Sirius shows no sympathy for his godson. When Harry tells him his summer was lousy, only for some comfort, Sirius tells him that he doesn't know what he was complaining about, as he would have welcomed the Dementor attack.
Wait,
then completely dismissed Harry's problems,
that,
and once
that,
found out his
problems
were worse, as he isn't allowed to step outside.
Your chance is one. Kill him.
Well, we need your help. To go outside. Comparing how Harry was alone while summer, left in the dark by his closest friends, to how he can't leave the house, but meanwhile is surrounded by those closest to him. I know this is hard for Sirius, as he always wants to be in the action, but he should have no sympathy at all for his godson. And Hermione had it right when she said that Sirius was selfish, something that is quite the opposite of the last 2 weeks, especially when it came to Harry. Now, it looks like in one scene in the movie versus the book. In the movie, I'm discussing the scene where Sirius talks to Harry after his dream where he was the snake, and after Harry says that he thinks he's a bad person, Sirius tells him that he's not a bad person, but a good person and bad things have happened to him. This, in turn, calms Harry down and makes him feel better, and Sirius hugs them, saying that they
were dead.
During the same conversation in the book, Sirius just disregards everything Harry says, telling him that he didn't sleep, but it was just a dream, and that his anger meant nothing, and finished by telling him to stop worrying. It's no help to Harry whatsoever.
One day I could join Marvel Comics.
Sirius could have literally calmed him down so easily as he did in the movie, but instead, he's once again selfish and just disregards Harry. In another instance, Sirius goes on to literally scream at Harry when he asks a simple question about his name, something that takes Harry aback, and should take the audience aback, because this is not the Sirius we're used to. I know there are logical reasons why he's grumpy and angry all the time, and didn't just come out of nowhere, but at the same time, I wish Roman would have taken a different approach with his character, especially because he ends up dying at the end of the book, and all we remember is him being a jerk to Harry, being insensitive, and him whining all the time. It's not that his death isn't powerful, but I think it would have been more powerful if we had grown to love him more in this book, rather than grow to dislike him, or now I should say, dislike the way he's acting. I think his death in the movie is far better, because they did just that. They made us fall in love with Sirius more, and therefore, it was more gut-wrenching when he came away. One of the worst things in the entire Harry Potter series is SPDW. Hermione's organization to help house elves, when in reality, they don't want to be helped. It was formed in Goblet of Fire, and it was very annoying there, it was bearable. However, it gets so much worse in the Order of the Phoenix. Every night, Hermione knits and puts clothes out for the house elves, hoping that when they clean the common room, they pick it up and are set free. Because if they are given clothing, they're set free as a result of Goblet. There are just so many problems with this. If the elves did pick them up, the school would kind of be screwed, because they would lose the cleaners, the cooks, and the creatures that basically keep the school running. All but one of the house elves actually stopped cleaning the Gryffindor common room because of Hermione's clothes. When Dobby picks them up every night and is now the only one that cleans it, but because her clothes are gone every morning, Hermione thinks that she freed all of these house elves and flew the school over, and she's proud of it. Hermione's a smart girl, smarter than average. She should know that the whole SPDW thing is a dumb idea. And even more, she should be able to see that house elves enjoy working and don't want to be separated. There are some other very cringy things in this book, like the Weasley is our king's son, the song that Malfoy made up to throw Ron off from the Quidditch matches. And though I liked the way the Gryffindors turned it around, it was something that I never really liked, and was one of the reasons why I was glad that they cut Quidditch from this film. I just found the whole thing sort of ridiculous, and honestly, just straight up cruel. And how the professors don't step in and stop this is beyond me. Another thing I didn't like was Harry literally attacking
his deer
after a Quidditch match. Malfoy was just doing what he was always doing. He was bullying and pushing Harry's buttons by any means necessary. And this time around, he's talking about his mother, something he's done so many times. But here, Roman is Harry go out of character, and not just hit Malfoy once, but hit him many, many times. And he hit him so hard that he bruised his knuckles on Malfoy's jaw. Me personally, it's fine if you disagree with me, because as I said, everyone thinks he's most different. But I think this is very out of character. Why is it that this is what makes Harry snap? A line that is not even close to the worst thing Malfoy has said about him or his parents. We know for sure that this wasn't Voldemort's influence on his anger the way it was a bunch of other times in this book, but it was just Harry and Harry alone. I can see Harry making a move at Malfoy, which I actually praised in the film with Ron holding him back, but it's clear that at the most, he would have hit him once the way Hermione did in the third book. But in the fifth book, this is on another level of brutality that I don't like to see from our main hero. I feel that, like, the music is our big song. It just promotes bullying and violence. Something that the series is pretty good at avoiding for the most part is making the magical fights. There are a few moments here and there, but in those fights, it's Mr. Weasel just pushing Mr. Malfoy with no kidding. Or it's Neville standing up to his bullies who physically torments him pretty often. But it's never vicious fighting the way we see it here. And again, you might completely disagree with me. This specific critique is pretty opinionated. And ironically, it's probably going to be the most controversial topic I discuss in this video. Moving on to something else that I think is just beyond awful in this book is Cho Chang. In The Goblet of Fire, she was a good solid character that was liked for a Phoenix. But in The Order of the Phoenix, just hate her. She's crying all the time, she's back and forth with her feelings for Harry. And of course, she has reason to be after losing her boyfriend Cedric. But she goes on to try and use Harry to help her through her grief, and then gets mad at him when he can't do it, which every time I read this, just always made me so mad. This is especially true when the two go on their Valentine's Day, where on top of talking and crying about Cedric, she tells Harry that she was asked out by Roger Davies, who was sitting right next to them kissing another girl. Then she eventually gets up, yells at Harry, then walks out, leaving Harry there, highly embarrassed. There's just so much relationship drama in this book, but I personally am not a fan. They're friends, then they're dating, then they get into a fight, then Cho apologizes to Harry, then they have another fight, and then Cho ends up with Jimmy's ex-boyfriend. And through it all, Cho does nothing but try. When I made my video about her, a lot of you agreed with me in the comments, making fun of her crying, saying that she's too much, this and that, and it's clear that it's not just me that feels this way, but many other people as well. Cho and all of the relationship drama was just too much for me, especially when it's bad for it, but again, that's just my opinion. Some of you might like the relationship. For me, though, putting what I think to be the really written Harry and Cho's relationship side by side with the very well-written Harry and Jimmy art, it's clear that the fifth book lacked a charm that the sixth book captured so well with that much for me. Anyway, I saved the biggest complaint I have about this book for last, and that is the final battle of the Department of Mysteries. Now, I'm not gonna lie, my view of this sequence was heavily altered by the movie, which might not be fair when judging the book, but that's just how it is to me. I'm not gonna lie about that. In the film, I love the unity that the kids have. They're together for the whole battle, fighting side by side. Harry's forced to give up the prophecy to save all of his friends. One of his friends is in favor, coming in just in time to save Harry, reminding him of the love inside of him, which in turn made Voldemort let him go. The sequence is not long, it's great. It's mysterious, and it's hard to believe. I think it's very long, and it's very drawn out. Getting into the battle alone just took so long. When we finally did get to the Department of Mysteries, I was so pumped and ready for a fight, but we still had a long way to go until the last battle. They find themselves in a circular room and have to figure out which door is the right one. It's almost like the mission of the first book, where they had to get through those obstacles to make it to the snow. But here it doesn't work like that. In the first book, each one of them had to step up and do what they were good at, but here they're just guessing which door it is, not doing anything special. The sequence takes so long. They end up going to the circular room, make their way to the brain room, then back to the circular room, then to the death chamber, back to the circular room, then to the time room, then to the Hall of Prophecies. That's a lot of things to delay the action of the audience that's been bored for the last 3.5 chapters. This is another example of bad pacing in this book, and it drains the excitement the audience was feeling, and for me, it was just left me frustrated. Sure, it was cool to get a tour through the Department of Mysteries, but this was not the time to do it. It takes away from the excitement of the climax. Also, the Department of Mysteries doesn't really pay off. You don't see it again for the rest of the series, and it might make some good lore. I even made an entire 13-minute video on it. But ultimately, the only thing that's really added was having the time turners be destroyed, Rowling saying they left too many problems. But then she made the cursed tile of canon, and made the time turners come back. So the one thing it added to the story was now irrelevant, but I'm not going to talk about the cursed tile, because you all know how I feel about that. There were also some weird moments in the sequence that I felt didn't feel like Harry Potter. And again, this is just my opinion. I disagree with you. But the Death Eater with the big head walking around with the zombie just felt like something that didn't belong in Harry Potter. And the same goes for Ron being so defeated and called a mission great to him when he gets wrapped up by his tentacles. Sure, this is entertaining, but this isn't the action I wanted, especially when I'm so eager for the climax, and I've been waiting 3.5 or at this point 4.5 chapters for. As I said, in the movie, they kept the kids together and showed unity, and that was arguably the best part of the sequence book. But in the book, they split the kids up, and they have no unity whatsoever. The six start off together, but then Harry, Hermione, and Neville split up from the other three, and it eventually comes down to just Harry and the Death Eaters when Lucius asks for prophecy. In the movie, Happy Hunter could go there to save his friends, who were all around him in terrible need. But in the book, his friends were all left behind. Sure, Neville eventually comes back, and pretty much screws everything up, breaking the prophecy, and making it impossible for Harry to get him out of there, because he was hit by a curse and makes him dance non-stop. I feel as though the book doesn't carry the same sense of danger, excitement, and camaraderie that the film did. And now that I've been spoiled by the film, I can never see the book the same again, because the film outdid it by so much. Overall, I love this book. For every bad thing that I pointed out, there are three good things. I literally made a whole video on how this book increases the most important conversation in the Harry Potter series.
I love this character.
But this video is about the flaws I saw in the book. That was my argument on why I believe this was the weakest of the seven in the series. I'm sure many of you will disagree, and I'm sure many of you will. But I gave my argument and gave my points of why I feel the way I did.
Oh, good.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I've said many times that The Half-Blood Prince is my favorite book in Harry Potter series. And many people have tweeted at me, asked me in the comment section, and DM'd me asking why I thought this. So now, in this video, I'm finally going to answer that. I'm going to explain why I feel that way. Though this is a book review, I'm going to use
this with the films,
because that would just make the video more visually pleasing and entertaining for you guys. Also, there are obviously major spoilers for this book, every other book in the series, and in turn the films as well. So
yeah.
Before we start, I just wanted to say that I'm going to stop using the YouTube community tab as much as I have been, and start using other platforms more so that the videos like Grand accept as just YouTube, just in case the worst happened and I lost the channel. So make sure you follow me on Twitter, which is the most important, because that will sort of replace the YouTube community tab. I'll be posting the most updates there, and that's linked down below. You can also follow us on Facebook, and if you want, you can follow my personal Instagram as well, which is full of cute dogs, behind-the-scenes replaying stuff, and just some fun posts. Both of those are linked down below as well. Now, let's get started. The Half-Blood Prince has some of the best character development out of all seven books, moving their arcs forward, starting new relationships, and even having characters' arcs come to an end. But in order to understand why this is the best book, we need to look at the entire series. Every book has so many great character moments and development, but when simplified, each book belongs to a character.
Jeez.
The first book obviously belongs to Harry, as it was our introduction to his character. The second book belonged to Ginny, starting her first year at Hogwarts, writing it, throwing away, and stealing the diary, and obviously being the one behind all of the attacks. The third book belonged to the Marauders, serious, stupid, and adding you to the center stage, plus the constant mention of James throughout the book. The fourth book belonged to Marty Crouch Jr., the man behind the plan of putting Harry's name in the Goblet of Fire, and pouring the strings of basically everything that happened, including Voldemort's return. The fifth book belonged to Neville, as he came into his own with the DA.